morning, ladies. We are so excited for you to be joining us in our last week of Psalm 119. My name is Abby Kilgore. I am the new Women's Ministry Coordinator here at Green Acres, and I'm so excited to be joining you guys for this Bible study. So before we get started, I'm going to give you a few announcements and make sure I'm in the camera frame. Awesome. All right. And so first things first, Connect Sunday is happening this Sunday. So if you're in the Tyler area, we would love for you to come and join us here at Green Acres for the restart of our Connect groups, which is formerly our Sunday morning Bible study. And so if you're in the area, we would love for you to come and join us this Sunday. And also check online because there are a couple of changes to the meeting times of our services. And then next thing is we have Fall Friendship Dinner coming September 1st. So please register online. We would love for you guys to come and join us for that dinner and to kick off our Bible studies this semester. It's going to be a great night. Dinner will be provided. It's going to be awesome. So please join us then. Next week we have Life Together. And so that will be on Facebook Live from 12 to 1. And so please join us for that. It's going to be a really awesome time to just come around God's Word together. And then lastly, we have Flourish Ministries, which is our discipleship ministry. And so if you're interested in being discipled or discipling other women, we would love for you to join us in that. So for more information on that, you can look at greenacreswomen.org, or you can go ahead and email Taylor Ballou at taylorb@mail.gabc.org. So now I'm going to, well, first off, we also have our map in the office, and you can't see it on the camera, but we have this map to show us exactly where all of you women are tuning in from. We have over 30 states, almost 40, that are tuning in from all over the country, but also women from all over the world. We have several different countries represented, and so we are so happy that you guys have been watching us. So now I'm going to introduce Leanne. She is our teacher today. She's going to be leading our study, and it's going to be awesome. So Leanne is an incredible leader. She and Debbie used to work at Prestonwood Baptist Church in Dallas together. And they are we're so thankful to have her here. She is a leader, she's an incredible teacher, and she's also an author. Her book was released today. It's called 24 Karat Life, and it's just a really awesome book about living every day refined by God's Word. So we're so excited to have her here. And so without further ado, I would love to have Leanne come on, and here we go. Ooh.
Hello, can y'all see me? Well, I can't see you, and so I have never done a Facebook Live, and so this is going to be fun. I want you to know that if I don't look at you and I look down, you'll need to have grace today, because this is a learning curve for me, but I could not be more thrilled to be with you guys today. I have lots of notes. I've been in God's Word studying. This has been the most beautiful passage to study. I've read it before, but I decided a few months ago, those of you who do follow me, I decided to start digging into God's Word through the Passion Translation. And I take highlighters and I highlight things God's, whoop, can you see this, that God's showing me? And I want you to know that there was so much that I didn't even know how in the world I would ever teach for 30 minutes on this. So we're just going to pray in just a minute that God's Word will just come alive, that the things that He's prepared for me to teach will be just something that will resonate with you, that will give you food for thought, that will challenge you, and that no matter what I prepare, this is how I always do. Anybody who's heard me speak, or, you know, nobody needs to hear from me. You all need to hear from Him today. So that's what I'm really hoping for. So if you have your study sheet, just know there's not a lot of questions. There's not a lot of fill in the blanks, but I gave you homework. So this is how I want to do it today. Let's pretend we're in a conversation. Let's talk. Let's let some of this just soak in, and then I want you to spend time in His Word without me when we're done today. Take these questions that are at the bottom and really dig in for yourself. So before we get started, let's pray and then let's kick it off. So Heavenly Father, we thank You so much for this opportunity to be with You today. Lord, I just ask that You would just draw the women in today that could just truly benefit from the questions that I'm going to ask them today. Lord, I know how You have refined my heart based on these same questions. Lord, I pray that my speech would be clear and that your word would be honored today. And we ask all this in Your name. Amen. So I've got a pretty big question for you right off the bat. And it's something that the Lord showed me. We're going to be talking today through, basically it's Psalm 119, 113 through 176. So that's a whole lot of verses that we're going to be trying to cover. But what I began to see is a theme pulling through here. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to be jumping around a lot. you're probably not going to be able to follow me and to catch every little thing. So just don't stress out about that, because you can get in God's Word for yourself later and find these same things. But the big question that came to me as I was studying is, and if you're filling in these top blanks, are you in like with God or are you in love with God? And that is a real question that I didn't even realize I needed to answer. And I want to read from you in this Passion Translation what drove this question for me. He says, "As a lovesick lover, I yearn for more of your salvation. Let me feel your tender love, for I am yours. Give me more understanding of your wonderful ways. I need more revelation of your word to know more about you, for I'm in love with you." And the first time when I was reading through this, I felt kind of like weirded out. Like, I thought, that's weird. I mean, to say I'm in love with God, like, that didn't make any sense to me. And I just kind of sat there for a minute and I was like, well, Lord, I mean, if it's in your word, and this is pulling very literally from the Greek and the Hebrew. And I thought, why would it say that? And so I thought, well, I'm just going to look up the word in love. I'm going to see what in love means. And so I've got some of these notes right here. Let's see if I can find it. Oh, man, this ought to be crazy. Me trying to watch my notes and watch this camera at the same time, but hey, we're going for it. All right, to be in love is not a sexual term. And that, you know, when you think of being in love, honestly, you think of, well, then that's somebody I want to have sex with, because you don't just love them, you're in love with them. And when I looked up the definition, it was just insane. It says, a profoundly tender, passionate affection for another, a feeling of warm personal attachment or deep affection. Seeing another as beloved. It says the benevolent affection of God for his creatures, or the reverent affection due from them to God. I couldn't believe it. I just thought, you know what? The world comes in and just infiltrates into our thinking in the most subtle of ways, and we don't even realize it. And so part of what we're going to be doing is digging through this and showing why his word is so important and why we want to know more about it. But I don't want to get ahead of myself. But this is what I started thinking. Well, I say all the time, well, I love chocolate. I love sushi. You know, I love my new car. You know, we throw the word love around. But the truth is, to be in love with something is so different. And you know, when I think about the things that I say I love, how much of the time, once I get them, does it quench my passion? If I get sushi, which we had sushi the other night, and it was delicious, and once I had it, though, I don't want it again the next day. And I started thinking about that, and I thought, is that how I am when I get what I want from God, when I get a good word from God? Am I good for about 2 weeks? Because, you know, I've got other things going. I've got things I need to do. I've got social media. I've got lots of stuff that I need to play around with instead of getting in his word. And I started thinking about it. I thought, oh my gosh, Lord, I say I love you all the time with that same fickle mouth that says I love chocolate. So I just really began to think about this. And so I said, Lord, just show me, like, am I in love with you? Lord, I want to know, am I in love with you? Could I say I'm in love with you, Lord? And my mind, being ADD as it is, I just thought, well, I'm going to do a Google search. I want to find out how you're in love. And I thought, I know it's going to be from the world's perspective, but something's just telling me that I should Google this and just see. And so you guys have got to hang on with me, because I'm about to rock your world. Because I looked this up, and this is, how can you know if you're in love? And as I read these, I want you to realize that they're writing from the world's point of view, but I dare you, to tell me that this could not be a litmus test for us on if we really are in love with God. You're addicted to this person. Love changes the brain. In the early stage of these relationships, it's like a euphoria that people feel. It heightens the neural activity in the dopamine-rich areas of the brain. As a relationship progresses into a long-term partnership, thinking about the partner activates the reward center. And it's like, it makes you want more of that person. And I started thinking about, am I addicted to God? Is it like to where I just can't get enough of him? Think about somebody you started dating. Think about those of you who've fallen in love, who've gotten married. You don't want to be without him. You're thinking about him all the time. You want to be with him. Is that what your relationship with the Lord is like? Number two was, you really want your friends and family to like this person. And I thought, are we really concerned that our family knows Jesus? Like, are we so in love with him that it bothers us that we're not telling our neighbors or our friends? Or are we kind of okay with it, keeping him a secret in our life? Because most of the time, you know, when you love somebody, once it goes Facebook official, that means something. So are we Facebook official with our love for Christ? Or do we say, you know, I don't want to offend anybody. I don't want to weird anybody out. So I'm going to keep that. That could be a real test to know if you're just saying you love God or if you're in love with him. Number three, would you celebrate this person's triumphs even when you fail yourself? And it goes on to say, if you've fallen in love with someone, you probably have an atypical reaction when witnessing them excel at something, but you don't. And then it goes on to say, you'll often feel pride and positive emotions when they see their partner succeed, even at something they themselves can't do, rather than feeling negative or inferior. And this came to me. I thought, do I celebrate what God's doing even when it doesn't benefit me? Even when I feel like my needs, my desires, my heart got ignored for the greater good of what God's trying to do. And I thought, when you're in love with somebody, you truly do celebrate their victories, what they're doing, what's happening on their behalf. You're not sitting around going, why me? You're happy for them. And I thought, how much of the time am I almost kind of mad at God because I feel like you didn't do it for me, though. You did it for her. You healed her son. You helped them find a path to success, but you didn't do it for me. So now I'm not going to celebrate you. Now I'm going to be mad, you know, rather than looking at it like, thank you, Jesus, that you're working, and God, you're working on my behalf, whether I see it or not. I'm going to celebrate this with you. Number four was, you really miss this person when you're apart. In many ways, how much you miss a person reflects how interdependent your lives have become. I thought this was so interesting. It says, if you're questioning whether you love someone, perhaps consider how much you miss them when they're apart. It says, it's been proven that how much people miss each other tends to correspond with how committed they feel to the relationship. And I just sat there for a minute and I thought, there have been so many times in my life when we have been praying for something and we get it, and then once that victory comes, it is crazy. It's like all of a sudden the Bible goes to the side because we're just in celebratory mode. We're just living life. Now we're going here. We're going there. We're meeting up with our friends. It's just a euphoria that happens. And all of a sudden, the very person who worked on your behalf is the one you don't seem to need anymore. And so I thought that was a really interesting thing. Do you miss God when you're not in his word? If you can go without being in his word for days, for weeks at a time, it's a huge question to ask yourself. Am I just saying I love God? Am I saying that I'm a follower, or am I in love? The fifth one was, your sense of self has grown through knowing this person. That was the other thing that it said, and I thought that was crazy. It says, when people fall in love, their whole sense of self changes. They take on new traits and characteristics, growing in diversity of their self-concept through the influence of their new relationship partner. It says, in other words, the you before falling in love is different than the you after falling in love. And I thought, oh my gosh. I love that, because that's the truth. When you are in love with God and you are in his word and he is guiding your life, you truly are not the same person. His word says you're a new creation. And other people will notice it and see that. And so if you're in love with him, your sense of self should start changing. You should start seeing yourself differently. And then the last one is, you're all in for the long haul. You're all in for the long haul. It says, relationship observers know that love needs commitment to flourish in a stable and healthy partnership. So my question to you is, how committed are you? You half in, you half out. It's kind of crazy, isn't it? But it's worth asking. The other thing, this, if you're filling in the blanks, the first one was, you know, he was in love with God. But the second one is, he is in love with his word. And as I studied through these Psalms, we're about to start really digging into this. It was just crazy to me, the types of things he said. Look at this, and I'm going to try to hold my Bible up where I don't lose eye contact with you. But the way this is worded is so gorgeous. It says, truly your message of truth means more to me than a vault filled with the purest gold. Every word you speak, every truth revealed is always right and beautiful to me. for I hate what is phony and false. Goes on to say, your marvelous words are living miracles. No wonder I long to obey everything you say. Break open your word within me until revelation light shines out. Those with open arms, with open hearts are given insight into your plans. It goes on to say, Lord, your judgments reveal your righteousness and your verdicts are always fair. The motive behind every word is pure and your teachings are remarkably faithful and true. He goes on and on and on. I could read just passage after passage where he just talks about how much he loves his word, how it's his life, it's everything to him. And I started thinking about how many times I've heard people say, I just want to read the Bible, I don't know, and I think about, honestly, those of you who are on the other side of this camera, if you were sitting across from me at a table right now, and I were to ask you, are you in love with his word? Most of us, honestly, have either said it, could say it, or probably questioning, I don't know if I'm in love with his word, especially based on that definition that I talked about earlier. So what I started thinking about, and I felt the Holy Spirit kind of burn down on me, is to share some keys to falling in love with his word. For you being able to come and write a passage like this, because this comes from the heart. You can't make this up. And so I started thinking, the first thing I would encourage you to do is find a translation that you enjoy reading. Especially if you're new to the word. If you pick up the King James Version or sometimes even the NIV, it's hard sometimes to understand everything that it's going, trying to explain. And so when you're reading and really reading to understand, I encourage you to have a second Bible or have something that you read that almost reads like a book, because those words just start coming off the page. And then the other thing is you have to read it, period. And that's really the first thing I'm going to say, but I scramble down past my notes. But if you don't read it, then you're not going to love it. You can't read an Instagram post. You can't watch everything live and expect to have some kind of osmosis that just sticks with you. People that get on the stage, people that do what Debbie does for a living, people that do what I do, all of us are just cheerleaders. We're sharing what he's teaching us really to spur you on to do it for yourself. So that's so important that you are getting in and reading and spending actual time. So the third thing that I feel like the Lord really gave me is to learn to ask questions about what you read. Because that's what happens when I talk to a lot of women. They'll say, well, I was reading and I just couldn't understand what he was trying to get at. And so I was just like, peace out. I just couldn't understand it. But rather than go, well, I don't understand this, I got to understand it. Like, if I didn't understand it, then I can't move on. And I started having this analogy of thinking about, what if you were trapped in a forest and you were just out there and all of a sudden you realized that somebody left you some notes, some instructions, and a cell phone, and it had all the bars. Not just one bar, but it had all the bars. So you had all the coverage you needed. But all it would do was go to Google. And you're sitting there and you're looking at this and you're like, oh, I'm going to read these instructions. And you look at them and they're in French, but you don't speak French. So you're like, this is how to get out of here. This is the solution to my problems. But yet, I don't understand it. So I guess I don't understand it. I guess I'll just stay here. I guess I'll just stay stuck. I mean, who would do that? You would take that phone out and you would start Googling and you would start going, how to speak French. And you would say, okay, I'm going to go to this website that translates French. I'm going to put these words in there and I'm going to let it tell me what to do, right? That's how we need to look at getting in God's word. Like, you can't just stop because you don't understand it. You have to ask the Holy Spirit to enlighten you, to give you understanding of it, and then you have to dig a little deeper. You may have to go and check out a commentary or call a friend or read at the bottom all those little things that are in your Bible that explain the time that this was happening, what was going on behind the scenes, and that will help you get a better understanding of the word. When you do things like that, that's when the words start coming off the page for you. And then the last thing that I was thinking about with this is you got to believe it till you believe it. It's just as simple as that. At some point, you have to go, this is the word of God. This is the truth. This is the absolute truth. And it doesn't matter what the world says. It doesn't matter what my friends say. It doesn't matter what the media says. It doesn't matter what's being shoved down my throat. This is the truth of God. This is my litmus test for every decision I make. And there's going to be times when you go, well, I don't know if I believe that. When you tell yourself, well, believe it anyway. Just believe it. And then the more you're in the Word, and the more the Holy Spirit starts to bring revelation truth to you, just like this says, revelation light coming off the pages, then next thing you know, you're going to start lining up, and you're going to see your heart and mind start to understand things you never thought you could. And you're going to start to live a powerful life that will draw others to Christ as well. So I want you to know that once you're exposed to His Word in ways like that, you'll never unknow it. The only thing you'll do in your Christian walk from that point is just get deeper revelations of it. I can't even hardly say that without tears because it's so true. God just continues to build on the little tiny truths that you learn along the way. Then you go back and then He just builds upon that and builds upon that. And next thing you know, you have a solid gold fortress in your heart that protects you from the lies of the enemy, from the feelings of disappointment. You learn to trust in ways you never thought you could. And so I just encourage you to get in His Word, to read it, to dig deeper, and then to just believe it, because that's where the power comes in. The third blank we're going to fill in is that He knew how to keep the love, and that blank is alive. How to keep the love alive. And I started thinking this whole theme of, you know, He's talking about that He's in love with Christ. And He's in love, I'm in love with you, God. And I started thinking about, well, if we're sticking with this whole thing, you know, they talk about that we're the bride of Christ. So I started thinking about brides and spouses and about when you get married and you start a relationship and a union with that person and you're committed for life, you're all in, all these things that we've talked about. How do you keep the love alive? Because anybody knows that if you're married, you can't get married and not do things to keep the love alive. The relationship will break down. You will start to see little cracks and crevices, and that closeness will not be as intense as it was at one time. So I started thinking about it, and I thought, what are some of the ways that even with a spouse, if you think of it like that, how do you keep the love alive? One of the things that the Lord brought to me was you have to choose to see the best in that person. And I started thinking, you know, some of us are mad at God because He did not come through for us. How many times have you mad at your spouse because either He didn't say the right thing, He didn't show up at the right time, He wasn't sensitive where you thought He should have been extremely sensitive? And I think, you know, we take those same kind of relationship type thought processes into our relationship with God because we're like, Lord, you didn't come through for me. Lord, you didn't do this for me, Lord. And now I'm kind of mad at you. And one of the entries that I wrote in my new book that's coming out is about your focus and where is your focus. Because if you're focused on the things you're disappointed about, then that's the place you're going to ride to. If you want to ride or die on the promises of God. You have to retrain your brain to go, you know, I may be disappointed in this, but God, you're good. God, you're loving. Just like you would a spouse, Lord, He didn't mean to hurt my feelings, God. You know, He didn't mean to be insensitive. You know, you just have to tell yourself, this is a good person, this person cares for me, God loves me, God cares for me. So you've got to be at a place where you choose to remember the best about God and not focus on the parts where you think that He was not faithful, because He's always faithful. He's always working behind the scenes, and that's a trap of the enemy. Just like it's a trap of the enemy in relationships today, to focus on the things that bring you heartbreak and disappointment. So the second one was, that you have to engage on a regular basis. And we kind of talked about this already, but a relationship is a two-way street. Like if you don't get to know that person and you're not doing all you can for them and them doing all they can for you, then the chances are you're not going to stay close for very long. And so I thought, you know, God never leaves you. You don't ever have to worry about that. You more have to worry about the part of you kind of the one walking out on that relationship. It is a two-way street. And if you notice through this, in verse 131, he says, I open my mouth and inhale your word because I crave the revelation of your commands. I just loved that because I thought, that's what it is. You've got to crave it. You've got to want it like that. You have to let him know you can't live without him. How many of you know that husbands need to know you need them? They need to know that they're loved. They need to know that they're protectors. They need to hear that. And I thought about, if you read through this psalm, it's incredible how many times he lets God know he needs him. Listen to some of these. Lord, strengthen my inner being. Your promises are all I can live by. Empower me to live every moment in the light of your ways. Let me hear your promises of blessing. He goes on to say, prepare a path for me. I don't even want one sin to have dominion over me. And it says, the motive behind your every word is pure. Your teachings are remarkably faithful and true. He says, answer my passionate prayer, Lord, save me, God. Lord, listen to my heart's cry. Breathe life into me again. He goes on and on and on, basically saying, Lord, you're my everything. I'm going to tell you, when I look into the eyes of my husband, my precious husband that God gave me, and I say, you're my everything. Do you think he looks at me and goes, okay, whatever. It melts his heart. And just like that, we melt the heart of God. He doesn't need us, but he created us to have just a relationship with him and conversation with him. And so when we come to him and we basically say, I recognize, God, that you are everything to me. That just brings a closeness with him. I also had, you got to stick together through the good times and the bad times. If you're going to make it in that relationship. This is what I found in Psalm 119 as well. Listen to this. He says, even though my troubles are overwhelm me with anguish, I still delight and cherish every message you speak to me. Give me more revelation so that I can live for you, for nothing is more pure and eternal than your truth. I thought that's such a beautiful picture because obviously it's showing everything's not going right at that time. But he says, but even though I'm overwhelmed, I still delight and cherish your word. I still cherish you, Lord. I still believe that you're working. And that's part of what keeps that relationship thriving between you and God. Because again, he's not leaving. It's us that leaves mentally and emotionally and sometimes physically. Whenever the overwhelm hits, we don't run to him, we run away. And so that's a part, that's something we've got to change in order to keep these relationships really strong. And the last one, it kind of coincides with this, but it's just a little bit different. But it's never let go. If you want a relationship to stay strong and to last, you never let go. And I started thinking so much about the key of God never letting go of us, but how we want to be holding on to him. And sometimes everything feels so fickle and unsure, and we are living in times where everything causes unsurety. If you get online, you're going to be unsure in about 2 seconds. If you turn on the TV, you're going to get unsure. If you start having conversations with people about everything that's going to go, you start getting unsure. And I thought about, this is a time for us to lean in like we never have. This is a time for us to start digging for the gold in God's word like we've never known, because that's the only way for truth to come forward. Do you know the only way to expose a lie is with truth? So if you're not exposing yourself to this truth, you're going to believe more lies than you ever realized. And I started thinking about, at the end, how many times I've told the Lord, Lord, I'm never going to walk away again. I'm never going to stray again in my thoughts, Lord. I'm just going to seek you with everything I've got. And how disheartening it is at times whenever I'll come to a place and realize, my gosh, I'm off the track again, Lord. Gosh, my attitude today was so stinky that there's no way anybody could have seen a reflection of you and me. That was not shiny, what I just said to my husband. And, you know, I just think about that. And I, as I read through his word, I want to close with this because I thought it was so beautiful. These are the last verses of this passage, and it starts with 169. He says, Lord, listen to my prayer. It's like a sacrifice I bring to you. I must have more revelation of your word. Take my words to heart when I ask you, Lord. Rescue me, just like you promised. I offer you my joyous praise. For all that you've taught me, your wonderful words will become my song of worship. For everything you've commanded is perfect and true. Place your hands of strength and favor upon me. For I have made my choice to follow your ways. Because, ladies, it's a choice. You got to make it. I wait for your deliverance, O Lord, for your words thrill me like nothing else. Invigorate my life so that I can praise you forevermore. And may your truth always be my strength. But this was the key. I'll never forget what you've taught me, Lord. But when I wander off and lose my way, and I was like, okay, Lord, there I am right there. Lord, I'm never going to leave you. Oh, but by the way, when I do, But this is what he says. I'll never forget what you taught me, Lord, but when I wander off and lose my way, come after me, for I am your beloved. And I just thought, that's just so beautiful. That's what I want you to have, is just to know that you are God's beloved and that he is yours. And it is all about relationship. And I think about my daughters are married to amazing men. I love Trent and KJ like they were my own. I mean, they are an answer to a prayer. There's just not enough words to speak their praises. But Valley and I were talking the other morning, and we were talking about the fact how thankful I was for the boys and how I knew how committed they were to my girls and how much I loved Trent because I was talking to her at the time. And she said, yeah, Mom. She goes, Trent would never let me leave him. She goes, even if I was a pistol and I tried to go, he wouldn't let me leave. And I thought, what a gorgeous picture of love and of having that assurance that no matter how silly she might get, how silly I might get, how silly you might get, God will never let us go. He is always going to run after us. Every time we take a wrong turn, he's always going to be there to turn us around. But it's this precious word. It's this right here. This is how he does it. What other people say, what he's done for them, is not going to last when the trouble times hits. It's going to be what he says to you personally in these beautiful words. So I just want to encourage you, get in it. Dig into it. My new book is called 24 Karat Life, and it all is about digging into God's word. One of the great hashtags with it now is gold diggers. And when I told my husband that one of the hashtags would be gold diggers, he looked at me, he said, babe, that's not really looked upon. I said, well, we're taking it back. We are taking it back in the name of Jesus, because there is gold in this. And even when I read through this, can you imagine how I stood up and squealed when it said that you're like a vault filled, your word is like a vault filled with the purest of gold. And I was like, oh, I knew it, Lord. So when I was writing that book, I hadn't even come across this translation and how that was written. But it was just confirmation that the treasure is right here. This is where the treasure lies. It's not in successes. It's not in anything other than his perfect will being accomplished in your life. So I want you to know today that I am praying for all of you, Lord. Lord knows who's watching, so Lord, I just cover them right now in the name of Jesus. I ask that you stir a passion in them that only you can do. God, I pray that when they pick up their Bibles, Lord, that the words will just come alive. I pray that you will give them Holy Spirit revelation, that this will be a light for them for the days to come. And so I just ask that you bless them in rich ways, God. And we ask all these things in your name. Amen. And so, God, you guys go out and get on LeighAnneKirkendall.com and sign up to go get this book. I have to tell you the best part of this really quick, because it is the sweetest part. After I had the book written, it's with the publisher, and I'm waiting. I was writing a Bible study to go with it, and I wanted the Bible study to be a free download, because this is a devotional. Some are short, some are long, but they're all about getting into God's Word and letting it refine your everyday choices. So I thought, I want them to dig deeper. I don't want them just to read my devotional and then put it up, and then it's like, then they're on their way. You know, they got to dig for themselves. And so I was writing this out, and I wanted everybody to have different ways to study, have all these things, different perspectives, all of this. And so I was going, and it was just starting to get kind of hard. And one morning I was studying through Philippians. And basically in the translation I was studying, it says, if you want to be great, make somebody else greater. If you want to make an impact, bring somebody else along. That's how it was worded, and literally, it just dropped on me. Leanne, I've given you all the parameters for this study. The problem is you can't be what 50 women can be. And so through that, I ended up with 50 women who bought in to coming alongside you and showing you how to study God's Word. Each woman owned one entry in the book, and what they did is read the devotional and then went through and crafted their deeper dig into that particular subject. And they're going to take you through it. You're going to learn all different kinds of ways to study the Bible, different ways of thinking, different kinds of questions to ask. They're from all over the country. And you're just going to love it. And there's going to be a 24-karat playlist as well. And if you get on Spotify, all the songs will be songs that will encourage you and keep you going and keep your heart tender toward the Lord. And My goal is to see you shine. I want to shine. I want you to shine too. So go out there, be shiny this week, and know that you are loved. We'll see you guys later.